I can't begin to describe what an honor it is for me to be here appearing in this wonderful crowd in one of my favorite places in London, which is the Frontline Club. But the extraordinary pleasure and honor it is to be chatting with Emmanuel Jal in this context. We keep running into each other. The last time was, I think, in Hyde Park during the concert there in July. I was wearing a t-shirt with a pit bull on it. It's an extraordinary story. Many of you perhaps know some of it, but it's a story that I can't begin to summarize. I'll give you some of the highlights, and obviously Jal will do best at telling it himself. But this is someone who went from not really knowing when he was born and being a child soldier to now singing before Nelson Mandela for his birthday. An extraordinary career, a career of being a child soldier, of trying to be a peace builder now, and as a musician. And actually, I think I'll just leave it at that and let Jal speak for himself.
Thank you for coming for the event to host it. And I just want to say also thank you to everybody who has made it tonight, and thank you to the club, you know. If thank you was money, then everybody would be rich by now. So I just say thank you one more time. Well, I don't know how to begin this, but I'll just continue. You know, the story, my story, a lot of people know it, and many people have questions in their mind, let's say, why do you have to keep on saying the same story? Well, I feel like I'm responsible. I don't, many of you knows survival guilt. You know, if you've been in a place and you see people dying and you keep on surviving, you go to another place and something happened, you're the only one who survived. Sometimes only you can give out information of events, of the things that have happened. If you don't talk about them, nobody would ever know. But voices of some of my friends, I still have them in my mind. Sometimes when I feel like giving up talking about my story, it's like they talk to me. They tell me, keep on representing us. Don't forget us. Don't get lost. And so I do this for many children who are suffering now. Nobody's representing their voice. Just recently, one of the moments that reached my heart, you know, is my brother's wife, like the brother to the wife of my brother, was taken when he was 13, when he was like 11, 12 from my home. And he happened to be a child soldier in Darfur, at 13 years old, participating in genocide. And so what he did, because of the things that he has seen happening, I don't, probably maybe he was raped or something happened. He started shooting his commander, and he shoot a couple of other soldiers with him. And now we can't hear. We can't hear what is happening. We don't know how he's gonna be judged. So now he's lost. So things like those are the things that keeps me to wanna keep on continuing talking about my story, because I'm representing many voices. I'm representing that old lady, that all her children died in the war. I'm representing that young man in my village that have no access to internet or newspaper to bring out his voice. And also the belief, the faith that I have in people, that people are the only one who can make this thing happen. There are good people out there when they hear these stories and they carry it with passion and push for the good things to happen. So let me just begin a summary of my story. Louder, you can't hear me at the back? Really, you guys can't hear me? Okay. All right, I have to be louder then. See, I really hear myself loud here, so I'm assuming. Well, I was born in South Sudan in a place called Ton. My father was a policeman and my mother was a nurse. So there was a tension between the South and the North. I didn't understand what was really happening because that time I was still a baby. So what I could remember is my mother crying and a lot of funerals, and my father disappearing. And when I hear adult talk, it's like when you're suspected to be supporting a movement that was formed in the South called SPLA, and then you disappear. So my father left us and went to Bantu in South Sudan and joined SPLA. What I'll do is I'll give the beginning of what happened, how I left my home, and how I got trained, and then I'll pick a part in my journey that motivates me every day in every step that I take. So me and my mother had to try to, and my other brothers and sisters had to try to follow where my father is, so we moved to South, and we had to stay with my grandmother. So the only way we're able to survive, how our grandmother was able to get us food, was she used to make alcohol. And sometimes she get beaten, she was arrested. But there's something about the alcohol she used to make, because the commanders of the government, the head of the police, likes her alcohol. So when she's arrested, they miss the alcohol, so she's released, and she make the alcohol, you know. And that's the way she was able to feed us, until she was the only one allowed to make alcohol. And she was a very clever woman in the way she was doing her marketing. Is musicians, actors, or people who are funny drinks alcohol for free. And so when they go in their places, they just talk or sing, and more people come. Like, a couple of hours of alcohol always finish. And maybe I'll ask this club to practice the same, you know. And you get more people. So, staying in Bantu, for the first time for me to hear bombs dropping and big guns exploding, I thought the world was ending, because you see chickens running in different direction, people screaming, the next house is burning. Like, you can't understand what is really going on. So much noise, so much confusion. And so my mother, and like what she used to do is she used to lie with us on the floor and tell us, don't worry, God is gonna take care of us. So she'll pray with us and make us believe that there's God who will make everything happen. And so we just believe in her. And in the end, everything goes well. Maybe the next neighbor's house get burned and people died and we survive. But something happened. My mother decided to take us to the village. How she described the village for us, she told us, village is peaceful. There are giraffes, there are lions. You know how kids are obsessed about seeing animals and elephants and all kind of animals. So, and we are in a town, you cannot see those animals. So we were excited to go to the village. And in this part, I think, this is the part I'm about to share with the most inspiring moment in my life, and also parts that I normally laugh. You know, the last laughter I had was in this village where we went to. And so we went to village, so I was taught how to take care of cows. Imagine we have to walk naked. You're from a town now, then you're going to the village, because every kid, people walk naked there, so nobody wear clothes. Only women would wear skin height, you know, like the way Maasai's or the Turkanas. I think you guys know about Africa, Maasai. Yeah. So what happened is ladies are taught how to cook, and as boys, we dry cow dung, or we take care of cows and learn the things that the men do. And so one morning, what I could remember, which was one of the, I don't know if it's gonna be funny to you, but to me, it always make me laugh, is, before I shed, I'll say two things. We used to have baby sheeps, you know our sheeps. So there was one of them was a good friend of mine, so we used to play a game, a bang, head on head. So like, I'll move back, and then it move back, and then we hit each other's head. Then my sister would tell me, oh, don't do this, gonna crack your head. But I like it, and the baby sheep like it. So when it's tired, it goes and drink milk from the mom. When I finish eating, we play our game. So this sheep became my good friend. But one incident that made me laugh so hard was one morning, I'd just left, you know, we call them luak, where cows are kept. So I just came out of it. And, you know, I happened to follow a chicken behind. The chicken was just moving, you know, like the way they like poking things around. And so on our mud hut house, there was an animal which was the size of a cat, was really big. And you see, it's okay to swear online. Yeah, this part of the story. This animal has got a big asshole, really, really big. And so like flies were just around it. We call it jeer. I don't know if the scientists have discovered it, but that animal is in Sudan. They have to look for it. And so our chicken was just poking. And all of a sudden, I saw the chicken putting the head inside. And so the animal closed it, and it started running. So you're seeing chicken like this. And then I called. My sister was seeing a chicken wings flying and an animal running, and there's no chicken making noise. So she couldn't understand it. But I was the only one who saw what was really happening. So I was laughing my head out. But apart from that, was the last laughter I've ever had from during that time in that place. So after a while, the war reached my place, and our entire village was burned down. We lost everything. So me and my brothers and sisters, we were scattered. But we keep on gathering. You know, once this place is destroyed, people run. Whoever survived, they meet again. But the enemy keep following us. Until one of the village attacks, I happened to lose my mother. I didn't know how she died. And during that time, SPLA put down a law and said all kids should be taken to school in Ethiopia. And so my father gave me out. And so we had to walk our way to Ethiopia. It took us like a couple of months. There was no enough food, so a lot of us died of starvation on the way. And also, the water was a problem, and kids getting kidnapped on the way by other tribes who have lost their children in the war. So it was a very harsh journey for us. So how we're excited about Ethiopia is we're told, it's like you're going to a land of milk and honey. It was like we're going to heaven. The picture was painted. And we're told, like, if you want to fly a plane, this is where you can go and fly a plane. You go to school and learn how to read and write. And so I was so excited to go to Ethiopia. First impression, like when the first time I arrived there, I've never seen a white person in my life. So the first one I saw, I thought she was a beautiful albino. So we're following her around. Hello, how are you? Hello, how are you? You know, like, how many of you have gone to Africa? You see, like, kids get excited when they see a white person. They run. You throw them sweets, you're even making it worse. They'll run after you. And so here in Ethiopia, thousands, it was like a city of young children. Like I was so amazed by how it was, like so many young kids. But we're given food, so ready-made food. Then after a while, they brought for us maize. And we didn't know how to cook for ourselves. And so starvation began. So kids started dying because we didn't know how to cook food for ourselves. And what happened is diseases came. You see, like 6 years old, 7 years old, burying their own dead. So somebody dies, six of us, we just have to carry the person on the blanket to dig. We dig a place, and then we have to make our own prayers. Then one thing that used to happen is you find a small kid will ask questions. And if there's nobody to answer those questions, they begin to shake. And once they begin to shake, it's like we can't do anything about it because I don't know what it does to their mind. So if they had clothes on, they'll remove their clothes and begin screaming, running around.
and start shitting on the floor or climbing a tree and jumping down or committing suicide. And so it happened to me once where I almost lost my mind. What I did was what confused me was just a bag of maize. I was asking, how did they make this bag? Nobody was able to answer that. And I asked, how did they make the tires, you know, the car tires? And so nobody was able to answer those things. And then again, you're asking, why did the war happen? So I asked so many questions, where is my mother? Where? So all those kind of questions, and there was nobody. So, and I was almost losing my head, but luckily I didn't commit anything but to take my life. So we stayed in Ethiopia for a while, and then there was a big meeting that happened. So, where we were asked how many are willing to be trained to be soldiers. And the way it was done is, we asked how many could testify here that they haven't seen their village burn down, and how many could say they haven't seen their mother's rape or their sister. So everybody, every kid there, I would say maybe 80% of them have experienced seeing their home burn down. And so when we offered a chance to be trained, everybody put their hands up. For me, the imagination, what was going on in my head, was seeing my village burning. And one event was that made me bitter later on. If you read the book, some things I don't share live, but very live in the TV or everything, but you'll find them. One of the thing, which was the part that twisted my heart the most, was when we were on a track with my mother, and an Arab soldier took our food, and when we asked him to give us our food, he beat my uncle, and then he beat my mother, and then when I tried to stop him from doing that, he beat me too, and I fainted. And so the worst thing you could ever do is do something to a kid's mother when the kid is small, because the picture will be painted in their head forever. And so from that point, I would say a seed was planted in my heart of hitting, you know, a different kind of people that I came to, you know, knew later, okay, we're called Muslims or Arabs. So I hated any Muslim or Arabs. And I said, when I finish this training, I want to kill as many Muslims and as many Arabs as possible. And so that was the vision. I went for training. The training wasn't an easy one. A lot of us died in the training. It was a very harsh training. So we're taught properly. We're not taught like the way I've seen, like the child soldiers in Liberia, 1 week. We're taught like 6 months, 9 months, proper rules, discipline, proper like normal soldiers. Then the bigger ones were collected, they went to war, and the small ones were left in the refugee camp. So if Ethiopia was overthrown, and so later we have to move, we try to keep Mengistu on power, but we lost the battle, so we're pushed to Sudan. I'm gonna jump this part, so to a part in my journey which up to today affect me and give me strength to move on every day when I go through any kind of a problem. One morning, a friend of mine just tapped my back and told me, "Emmanuel, let's go." And I asked him, "Where are we going?" He did not tell me what was happening. So we went to a store, we collected enough maize, bullets, and ammunition. So I thought it's the normal thing whereby we go to the battlefields, whereby we're either going to collect the wounded or take the ammunitions and food to the guys in front. But what I didn't know is we were escaping. And so we crossed the river to the other side, and I asked him, "What is happening?" So he didn't tell me. So later on he told me, "Look, this is what's happening. We've been planning this for months. We've been planning an escape, but we did not tell you because you have a big mouth. You'd have gone and told everybody and would have been in trouble." And so I understood, because that time I hardly kept secrets, you know, but now you guys can trust me, you're gonna tell me everything. So the journey was supposed to take us like 1 month, but it took us 3 months. Reason being, the first 1 month we had enough food, and and everything was okay. The journey was slow because we were escaping minefields. One of my friends actually got caught. His leg got blown off by a mine. And so we had to leave him there. This journey to me was, I don't know, it's one of the most strange part that when I tell it to people, some people don't believe the things that I've seen there. So the first 1 month, our food ran over, and then as we approached the forest, we were told just to apply the basic soldier skill, eat anything that is available. Nothing is poisonous. So we began eating the roots, any plant of the trees, anything that we were able to find there. Other people got poisoned by some other plants, but I happened to survive. And things went on, and as we moved on, we're told by the commander was with us, and he told us we're gonna approach a very dry area. So make sure you carry enough water, and when you feel really thirsty, just take a sip. Don't drink too much. And so we listened to the instruction. Then when we move on that day, just like 12 in the noon, the temperatures were like hot, like 40 to 44 degrees there. Everybody had finished drinking their water, including the guy who was advising us. And so we had to keep on moving. We can't go back because we would be ambushed. And so we had to keep on moving. The first day, no water. We slept without water. In the morning, you know, like the grass get wet. So I would wipe my hand on the grass and I would lick it several times. So I started telling my friends to do the same, and all the other soldiers and everybody started doing that. So that's how we got water. So you wipe your hand on the grass. For a couple of days, that was our water. And then we had dry maize on our pocket, so we'll eat the dry maize. And the whole day, no water. You only get water like in the morning with the dew. But things became tough. So as we move on, it became much drier. So others began drinking their own urine. All of us were drinking our urine. But one of the most strangest things is we're taught to be brother skippers. But one thing I realized with human being, when you're pushed to your core, that's when you could really see who we are, really. Here's other soldiers who take a gun and put it in their fellow soldiers and tell them, fill this cup with urine. And so they will try to, whoever is bullying the person will try to drink whichever urine that is there, but it doesn't help them. So they get irritated and then they just shoot themselves. So what happened to me is, I always want to shoot myself, but there's something that always speaks in my heart, don't do it, just die normally. Do not do this, it's going to be okay. So, and I keep on moving. And like, when we leave somebody in this journey, like there's one guy we left, as I could remember, we had to lie to him that we are gonna comfort him. So he was put under the tree with his gun, and he was told, we are gonna come and pick you. So the next thing he did, he knew that nobody was gonna comfort him, so he shot him. So sometimes maybe they leave you with one bullet, because when you're leaving somebody behind, you wanna kill the rest of you. And so we left him and he shot himself. So we all move on into under one tree. Under this tree, we had a magician with us. And he said he'll bring us water. So he did his magic. No water. So we had another guy where he said his grandmother, they normally worship a snake. So he prayed to the snake to bring water. So there was no water. So all of us, you know, we're pushed to our limits to try to pray to as many gods as possible to give us water. So what I remember my mother, the way she used to pray with us, when the bombs used to drop and houses burning, she lie with us down. Then I said, let me pray to my mother's God. So I prayed to my mother's God and I waited for a while. Then after a while, a cloud like came on top of a tree, a small cloud. 100 meters away from the tree that we was really dry. So it started raining, and we got water, and we're all so happy. But the problem we had was there was another fight where we didn't know whose God brought the water. So the magician said he brought the water, the guy with the snake, I was saying it's my mother's God. So we had to leave the journey. We have to leave it there. No God was given a thank you. So we moved on with our journey. Here, we arrive in a much swampy area. And I began collecting snails on top of the water, put them in my pocket. And what happened at this part is if you happen to fall, nobody picks you. So you see, you just see bubbles coming out when somebody has fallen down. So it was a very, then mosquitoes were all over, so you can't wipe like this, you know, it's like a bunch of mosquitoes all over your body, you just wipe them. You have to just wipe them off when they're freely blocking your face. And we arrive under a much place that was high a bit. And I began roasting. I made a fire with the gunpowder, and I started eating the snails. Others started eating on the frogs. Anything that was available, they were able to eat. And so vultures were coming to eat the dead bodies, so we'd shoot the vultures and eat them. But after a while, the animals, the snails, everything began to disappear. Even the vultures would keep off. They don't come close to us. When somebody died, they don't. So it became very intense for us. And here, cannibalism began. The magician that was with us began roasting the dead body. So when somebody died, he would slash them and dry them, and he would start a fire, and he'll eat them. What I could say about testifying about a situation like that was my senses changed. Like, I look at my fellow human being, when I smell them, they smell like food. They smell like dry meat. I don't know if somebody ever eat a dry meat. And that's how like I wanted to eat somebody. And so my friend died, we put bombs around him. And we took it under a tray, hoping that if a hyena come at night, the bomb would explode and would eat the hyena. So the hyenas come, the bomb explode, none of them was killed. So they took the whole body. So that morning I went under the tree to see if there's any pieces of a dead body that I could eat, because I didn't want anybody to see me eating somebody. And so there was no any. And so I came back under the tree I was, and I look at my friend, and I told him, I'm going to eat you. If there's no food for me, I'm going to eat you tomorrow. That's the only way I'm going to survive. So my friend was dying, and he was looking at me. I didn't know if he could hear what I was saying. And so that night, I slept with, my head was really, it's like there's a parliament in the head here, you know, like your head speaking. There's a good one telling you don't do it, and then there's another part say do it. So one part of my head tells me, this is the only way for you to survive, you have to eat your friend. The other part of my head tells me it's a sin, it will haunt you for the rest of your life. So it was really a journey throughout the night. And so, and I said, okay. When things really get tough, I always remember my mother and the things she used to do to us as kids, and then I pray to our God. And so I pray and I say, God, if you're there, give me something to eat, that if someday I survive, I'm gonna tell people this story. And so I stayed the whole night. I gave God a couple of hours to prove if he exists. And 9 in the morning, 10 in the morning, just when like about, when I was about to lose hope, like at 11, a crow came. So a friend of mine shot the crow, and that's the crow that stopped me from eating my friend. And from there, people came and rescued us, and I ended up in a place called Ward, where I met Emma McCune, a British aid worker. I think maybe he's gonna finish it from there. And I was smuggled into Kenya. And into Kenya, I'm just going faster. I'm now here standing in front of you guys. So thank you.
Thank you. So your book is called Warchild. Your latest CD is called Warchild. And of course, those are concepts that are very difficult for most of us to put together. War means one thing. It means death, destruction, and all the things that we know of, those of us who have seen war, those of us who haven't. But people have a pretty good idea. And it's not something you normally associate with children. What's your recollection of realizing that perhaps you weren't really going to be a child anymore and that now you were becoming a man? Do you remember that time?
Yeah.
No, back when you were a child soldier.
Well, I would say I didn't know what was really happening. And so, you know, when you're trained, you kind of like forget you're a child because you go through the training and you've been brainwashed, so you have the gun, and the gun become your father and become your mother. And because you see what the power of AK-47, what it can do, it can kill. It can make a big adult plead for help in front of you. And what I didn't know was I didn't know the value of life, that you only die once. That's what I didn't know. So the transformation into being an adult, maybe when I was 18 or 20, that's when I was beginning. But it's hard for any person who have gone through hardship or any person with a trauma to actually grow.
Yes.
Because they live in their own world, like being very stubborn, and you try to reason with them, they can't see what you're reasoning. And it's like big adults who are babies.
Yes. Somehow you knew right from wrong, or in your own way you knew it, because you said you were reluctant to be eating another human being. Where do you think you got that sense from, that this might not be right?
Because I've never seen people eating human beings, and we've been eating the right foods. It's all there in the conscious. And nobody have ever told me don't eat somebody, but I found it like it's not the right thing to do.
You mentioned Emma, and it's the song that you played when we were coming in. It's the song about Emma is very prominent, and she's obviously an important part of the life story that you've had so far. Tell us about her. How did you meet her, and what happened?
Well, I met Emma after surviving that journey, and she saw me. My AK-47 was longer than me, and was dragging the floor when we're moving with a couple of other young people. And in that journey, I think it went around, people heard about it. Only 16 people survived. There were like 400 people, and 16 people survived. And so Emma smuggled me into Kenya, so put me in school. But she later died. And even when she put me in school, I used to fight her a lot. Because now I can remember the things I used to do that I will say I never appreciated her for what she did, because she take me to school, I'm kicked out of school, or I'm been kicked out because I fought or I've done something or maybe stolen something, you know. I would call it stealing, but that time it's taking. So if I like something from, I just take it. But to Emma, it's stealing. So she take me to her friends, and the kids have something. I like the video games. I put it in my bag, and I move with it. So she comes, this is wrong thing, you're stealing. To me, it's like that's when we're trained as soldiers. You just go with your gun in the village, you get what you want and go. And so for me, I still have all those things. And so because now I appreciate that she's an angel that came to my life and turned me into a different direction. And because of her, when I was educated, going to school and discovering the truth, that's when I was able to go through the healing process to forgive. And now I know what is killing us. It's not the Muslim. It's not the Arabs. What is killing us is the oil that we have. It's the fertile land. It's the things that we have that is killing us. And religion has been used to manipulate everything. And so, to her, she's, I don't know how to describe her, but she's an angel that God sent to bring me into life. And so how did that happen? Also putting me in school, so my mind is enlightened through education. And now the song called Emma is a song dedicated to her. And also because to go and challenge other women out there to be responsible, just to go back into the beginning, a child belonged to everybody, you know. And that's why you find somebody, an Asian can adopt an African kid, you know. And I'm trying to ask women, go there, give another kid a chance. Emma did it, here I am today making a difference. And I found a charity called Gua Africa now where I put kids in schools. And one thing that I'm doing now to show where I'm really serious about what I'm doing, carrying Emma's legacy, education. Because when she came to Sudan, she saw how the situation was complex, how the problem, how the women, how they were treated, young kids in schools, there's no girls' education. And so what she saw is if we build more schools and create strong institutions, this will be the only way we can help this country. And so now I'm carrying that on. I'm building a school in honor of her. And today is day number 309, in which I've been eating only dinner, no breakfast, no lunch, because I promised the kids in my village, and I told them, I'm not eating breakfast, I'm not eating lunch until I get the money. So. And now they're waiting every day on me, because I thought I was really that famous enough when I do that statement online and all the fans will raise the money quickly. But now it's taken me long, so I can't eat my breakfast and lunch, because those kids are looking up to me. If I start eating, they'll feel like I failed them or something.
One of the things that threads that runs through your story is one of betrayal on the part of other people. People misleading you, people telling you that you're to be sent to school, and you weren't. How did you learn to trust other people? Because that's such a fundamental thing to rob of a child, is that the trust that a child would have of an adult. How did you come to trust people?
Well, as a kid can easily trust anybody, because they haven't experienced hostility. So for me, I was able to trust. But on the way, I came to realize, and up to now, I always trust anybody I meet. But I know I prepare myself for the consequences of what happened. For me, when Emma told me that she's gonna put me in school, first of all, I had other question. Okay, white people, they sell people. So if she takes me, maybe she's gonna sell me out as a slave or something. So different people tell. So I had to choose. Okay, she's gonna take me to a country. What about if she sells me? Because she has no children. You know, we don't understand what was happening. She has no children, so maybe she's gonna make me a child or sell me or do something. So I had all those things in my head. But the other thing is, I just trust her, because the way she was handling things, about the things she was doing, the way she was smiling, and I said, okay, fine. In my head, I said, okay, fine. I'm gonna go to your mother, your homeland. You take me to school. I'll learn how to fly a plane, and I'm gonna steal a plane and come back to war. So in my head, I had my own plans. And she didn't know that. Me, I wanted to go to school. She took me to school, but I wanted to use her, risking not knowing what's gonna happen.
Music first enters in the, I mean, again, in your writing and so on, it's a common thread, not just obviously, and we'll come to that, but what you do now, but even singing before battle and so on, and the singing of the village, and a song is always to be heard in the background of your story. Tell us a bit about music in your life, even before you became the star that you are now. What did music mean to you as a child?
Music, there's something about music. Music is the only thing that can speak to your mind, your heart, your soul system, your cell system, and influence you without you knowing. One thing I remember is they brought for us an Arab musician to perform for us and the soldiers. What I didn't understand why we're able to dance to his music like only him alone, and going to war and just still hating Arabs and Muslims. So I didn't know why we would dance to his music, and he's an Arab. So you see, I couldn't understand that. I couldn't resist that. So, but now I understand what the power of music is. Music, it's almost like love, you know. Music doesn't tell color. You know, once you're in love with a woman, it doesn't matter where she is, you're gone. So for music, it's a form of therapy, you know. For me, personally, the way I do it, when I started doing music, I was doing it for me. I wasn't doing it because I want to help anybody. I was doing it because it makes me happy. And all of a sudden, I became known, famous. I wasn't even prepared for it, and I didn't even know what hip-hop is. So I had to try to catch up and do everything properly. But I was doing it because it was helping me. And in my village, there are all kinds of music. There's music when people are going to war. If soldiers go to war and they don't have musicians with them, and they happen to lose one battle, they have no morale to keep on going. So musicians were very important in singing certain songs, depending. When you lost the battle, there's a song to sing to give you strength to move on. When you're scared, there's a song to sing to make you aggressive. Mm-hmm. And so music was used. I don't know why it can work that way.
And a word about language as well. I noticed that in your music over time, you've used different languages, and I guess the most recent CD, with the exception of Bakiwara, it generally is in English, but in the earlier music, you tended to sing in other languages or rap in other languages. And tell me about what language means to you and how you choose when you use which language and so on. What language do you think in? What language do you dream in? Because you must know quite a few.
Well, that's a good one. Personally, for me, I've moved from one place to another. So my mother tongue is dying out, like, because I'm not with people where I can practice speaking it. I used to speak 8 languages. And so now my strongest is English. And so when I'm writing music, is sometime I run out of a word from this language, so I put in the other word from that language, and it complete. And then with the hooks, it just happened like that, finding a good flow in the chorus. So like a song like Bakiwara, it has got Arabic and Swahili. And a bit of Nuer. So I've mixed like 3 languages in that one chorus.
You obviously have strong views about hip-hop in general. All I need to do is say 2 words to you, 50 Cent. Tell me something about 50 Cent and how you feel about what he represents in hip-hop.
Well, when he first came out, we liked what he was doing, and it was real, you know. It's like, it's a form of therapy, probably for his gang and whatever he went through, so I enjoyed that. But the part that made me angry the most was how the music has been used, and people don't know its power on what it does to children. And so, it's not only hip-hop alone, but I pick on 50 Cent because there's no other very influential hip-hop artist that is around all over the world now like 50 Cent that a lot of young people look up to and make them feel aggressive. So it increased violence. Like my cousin in London, they formed a little group and they bully kids at school. So he ended up starving a white kid and he was arrested for that because he wanted to feel like he's a gangster. And to me, in my head, I say, wow, our country's at war. You've come to this country, they've given you opportunity to go to school. Now you're turning yourself into killing this. But for me, when I look at it, it's deeper. He can't get it. So I had to see, how did this happen? So I found, okay, it's the musicians here who are their role models that they're looking up to, and that's what they're acting. Because music can influence you indirectly. So if you listen to a certain kind of sound, whether you like it, after a couple of months, you begin to act like that. Mm. Just like if some of you listen to reggae, I think maybe now you're smoking weed or something. You know, and start saying, yeah, man. Yeah, for me, I'm slow like this, so don't think I'm smoking weed. It's because of my hunger strike, so it has given me some side effects while I'm moving like this. So you see like some rock guys, like how amazing they look. You know, you find some with a big ear and then they put something, and then it's putting tattoos all over. You see, that's the music they listen to. So and even like sagging, you know, young people, me also dressing halfway, it's hip hop. Mm. The way people move their hands. You can see the music you listen to will affect, like even the swear word has been magnified in hip hop. And you find like kids using it sometimes. It's because they listen to that kind of music. And also, what I could say is probably him, he hasn't healed from his anger or whatever he is, because violence is very addictive. You know, like, it's sometimes, I don't know, the only way I run out of doing something bad is the music. So music is my safe haven, because sometimes you feel like you wanna, if I can even remember like some soldiers, when they're not deployed to go to war, they go crazy. They're only happy in the battlefields. So it's like almost some guys in the ghetto here who are gangsters, they're happy when they move around slapping somebody on the way or mugging a shop. They find it's fun. And so they're trying to portray that fun through the music. But to me, I'm trying to say killing is not fun. You know, you may try to do all these things for now, but they'll catch up with you in years to come.
Before I open it up to the audience, I wanted to ask one last question. You wrote in your book that people go back to the place of their birth just as birds return to their nest. Where is home for you?
Now for me, my definition of home is where you're loved, where you can relax and be free, you know? And I know maybe a lot of people will agree with me, you know, maybe some of you are married, when you go home, your husband beat you, you are scared if you're a woman, that's not home. Maybe you're happy at the working place, so that's home. So far now, my home is my music now. This is where I do, wherever I am, I'm happy. This is myself. So I'm learning to connect with the people, because with what I've gone through to protect myself, I have to keep my heart cold, but keep my head conscious to know this is the right thing to do. But in my head, I know where I was born. And I'm from there. And I remember things that happened. And because I've survived, I'm representing them. I'm speaking their voice. And if peace happened and I happen to get a chance, I'll go back home. Because that's where I was born. That's where my mother created me, or where, yeah. So I feel like it's my home. But here, I'm here because I'm a refugee, you know? I'm traveling. if there was no war, I'd still be there peacefully.
Thank you. I'll take some questions then. I thought I saw some hands, yes, back there, next to the aisle.
Yeah, hi, sorry. My question is, I realize that you refer to God quite a lot in what you say and in your songs as well. I just want to know what does sort of, where does God fit into the picture? What does he signify to you? And where does he actually especially fit in the picture when it comes to the suffering that you went through in your life?
Well, I have many questions. But throughout my journey, you know, and when I prayed and I saw things happen, I came up with a conclusion. I say, I'd rather believe there is God and find there's no God than not believe there is God and find there is God. And so faith gives me hope to see tomorrow. So my music is a painkiller for me to go through the problems I have. And so sometimes, like, having faith that someday things are gonna change, it's how I'm able to reach now today. Because I had faith then that I'm gonna move through that journey. And what I remember with the importance of faith is, even as a kid, I remember one of our neighbors, they had no food. So the younger girl, the one in the house, took an axe and put it in the pot with water and told the kids, keep on putting fire here. They're like, make sure you blow it off. And once this thing is soft, then it's ready for you to eat. So he kept the kids blowing on the fire. They would take the hot water and try to drink it, and they'll try to check on the axe. It's not yet soft. So he kept those kids waiting, and those kids had faith that this thing is gonna be eaten later. But that gave her time to go and get something for them. Luckily, she was able to get something and gave them to them and told, okay, this thing now, we'll keep on making it, and it's not so. Faith keeps you hanging there, you know, so. And as you buy time, things change. So that's why I believe. And because, you know, I believe there is God, because if I look at my journey, you know, if you even listen, if you read the book, there's a part where we capsized in a ship. And I did the same thing, just to pray, and something happened. And so for me, I said, okay, that God must be there. So let me just, even though not every prayer of mine is answered, some are not. And I really get angry, and sometimes I curse God, you know, all the words, you know. In my own world, I fight with God. I have my own question, and I tell him, why am I here, and why all this? And when I do that, in the end, when I finish, it become almost a therapy session for me also.
You're in the third row.
I met once with a child soldier in Afghanistan, and he was carrying two AK-47 guns. I asked him that, why did he carry two guns? He told me that he felt empowered. He felt bigger. He was like 13, 14 years old. So how did you feel when you had a gun? And what did life and death mean to you?
When I first had a gun in my hand, I felt the same thing. I was feeling powerful, and you feel strong, very secure, because you feel like the gun become your father, become your mother, become everything. To you at that moment, you can make an adult cry. So you feel good. There's something, and it's very addictive to leave your gun. A weapon, it's, when I was leaving my gun, it was hard for me to just let it go. It was really hard.
Thank you. Other questions there in the back row?
possible, I just want to commend Emmanuel for his effort, despite his tragic experience. And also, just to remind the audience that personally, the last 3 years when I first visited northern Uganda, and experienced firsthand what a child soldier goes through. And the thing that struck me the most was actually the stare in their face, which is so cold, confused, no love, no nothing at all. And it struck me really. And also, the fact that, you know, there's not been any international kind of help towards, you know, reintegrating such kids into a normal kind of life, which I find really quite puzzling as well. And also, the second point I want to make is that, you know, when people abduct a child, you know, they commit two very serious crimes. One of them is like, they destroy the present, and they systematically also destroy the future of these kids. So, the international community has tried their best to sort of like name and shame persistent offenders, which most of them happen to come from Sudan and Uganda. And in fact, there's also a very thin line between combatants, government troops, militias, and thugs. And that has never been established at all. But I just want to ask Emmanuel a specific question. Out of your effort, are you making any kind of attempt to actually confront the perpetrators of such horrendous crime? Thank you.
Oh, thank you for question and also highlighting the situation of other child soldiers. Well, for me, I'm making as much noise as possible. My situation in southern Sudan was different because we witnessed our homes burn down and we understood what the system was. And so when all of us were part of SPLA, we realized this is a war that we are fighting on our own. And this is to prevent our culture. Although for me, I was fighting for wrong reasons. Me, I was fighting for revenge. And a lot of kids, maybe, who are child soldiers, are fighting for revenge. Like, confronting specific leaders for doing what they do that I believe is wrong. I've been doing it, like, I've been making a lot of noise, sharing my story, like now. It's another way of creating awareness and getting people into know what is happening and pointing them it's happening here and it's happening here, because I know they can make it happen. And so for Uganda, the situation in Uganda, you know, like for me, what I'm saying, what I could add on it is, where there's no vision, people perish. So we have a lot of leaders in our continent who only have interest for themselves. They don't really have the interest for the people. And so I don't understand, like, even if you look at their situation with their families, their kids are in good schools. Just like the war is created and only the children of the poor suffer, but the rich make the war happen. And so it's really a hard thing, even talking to international community. Every community has got an interest. You know, China interest is the oil, so it gives Sudan arms. You know, maybe America interest is to follow the terrorists. And what really matters the most, the masses of people that are dying, nobody really care. And so we have the UN who's ready to give people food in the refugee camps, but at the same time, it's crippling, because if you're in a refugee camp and there's no schools for you, you'll still be bitter about what happened in your country, and you're not educated, you're not helping yourself in the future.
For me, what I believe for all this situation is education. Because if more schools are built and people are educated, the public are educated, and they know they can create a revolution and make things happen. And also, like, there's a part you mentioned about child soldiers. I had an experience when I was brought into Kenya. It's hard for other families to take me in because they judge me. Oh, he's been a child soldier. He has killed people. And also, even a child soldier, when they go to their family, they're different. They're not like any other kid. Their behavior is different. And so I feel like it's a big problem that need everybody. It just doesn't need the international community, but it also need the people, the leaders in the area, the people, the religious people who claim who are preaching God's word, because they should be the one to set the examples, and they're the one who are creating all these things, the wars that are happening. I'm still making noise as much as I can to the world and to the leaders so these things can be stopped. But it can't happen by myself. It needs everybody.
Thank you. Another question here in the front.
A lot of the conflict zones that I've worked in, sadly, in fact, the majority seem to have children soldiers, including Sudan, where I've been. Three quarters of the situations seem to have occurred through violent circumstances, where the children weren't forced into becoming soldiers, but actually their parents were killed or they witnessed extreme violence. And those children particularly tended to be quite almost more violent in some ways, or that was all they'd known, depending on their age, but usually sort of the age is about 13. Do you think that the therapy needed, or after the conflict is over, the children have a harder time to readjust or to, and should there be particular focuses on how to deal with child soldiers, because so many of the world's conflicts involve them, and they're not aware often of the causes of what they're fighting for. They've just seen injustice in their own families or such like. Do you think that the child, or do you think you've readjusted, you've managed to portion responsibility, and probably in your own case, your own responsibilities, but do you think other children need a lot more help because that's all they've known?
A lot of kids need help, because you can witness, see a lot of blood and just think everything will be okay. But the therapy is playing football. Now, for young kids, it's the easiest. The easiest people to do for therapy are young people. You bring them sport to play, or boxing, even athletics, football, music. Those are the first things, like, or even acting, things that will entertain them, because you have a lot of energy, violence. So you have to find out where you can direct that negative energy into be used into something. So now you've been trained to kill all of the time, you're just going to frontline. So now when you keep them busy in their mind, when they're playing football or doing boxing, so they find themselves entertain. So that will be first step of therapy maybe for them. Then from then on, when you introduce school, it will be easy for them to read than just taking them in school without giving them a form of entertainment. And also, it's hard for a lot of them to confess, but once you put them into situation like that, naturally they'll tell their story. Maybe they'll find somebody they feel comfortable with and they'll start sharing it.
Other questions here in the aisle?
Hi, I was just wondering, how hard was it for Emma to smuggle you into Kenya, and would that be possible to do if someone today, like the opportunity to, you know, get child soldiers out of the situation, if one, you know, wanted to help in that way, is it something that could happen, or was it just a chance that you did get to Kenya with her? and also school-wise and education now. What sort of is your hope with your school you want to build there, and how would you suggest that other people who wanted to sort of help setting up schools or anything like that, where's like the best place to do it, or how to, you know, get ex-child soldiers to know about it or to come to the schools? Like, where do you think is the best place to set them up and, you know, get the students? So basically there's two questions about how to sort of the best way to help, and also how hard it was for you to get into Kenya, really.
Well, it's not easy to just get a child soldier out. Emma has rescued 150 child soldiers and also managed to establish a lot of schools. So she has been there and the people known, and also she was married to one of the commanders, which made it easier, so she was known. So when she picked me, I don't know why she chose me, there are others. So I don't know why it happened to be me that she was really interested in. She would have taken three of us. Okay, she helped many kids, but putting them into school or integrating them into families. But she said she wanted to take me out of the country into a school. And so the way we did it, because I didn't have a document, I told her I'm going to apply my basic soldier skills. And I told her, okay, for you, dress nice and just smell nice. And smile at everybody. So, and that's what she did. She was dressing nice, smelling good, and smiling. So all the attention in our little airport was on her. And so when everybody was looking at her, I smuggled myself with the bags into the plane. And that's how I got into Nairobi. And in Nairobi, I got out of the plane, so I was just like normal kids. So we practiced, we did almost the same thing. Luckily, there were no cameras. Was in Lokichoke Airport and another airport called Wilson. So I was like any other normal black Kenyan kid. That's how she smuggled me. With school, the school that I'm building it in a place called Lea where Emma is buried. There are some areas where it's safe to actually build the school. Mostly it's the areas that are bordering the neighboring countries. But the reason we're building school there also as well is because it had got the highest number of child soldiers that were disarmed from SPLA. And so, and also getting those who have been disarmed is not hard, because children are hungry for education. They want to go to school. But those who are idle still go back to army. Because for a child soldier to take them to a normal home, it's boring for them. They can't fit in. So they find it more fun to be in the army territory.
Other questions? You're in the second row.
I noticed that in your storytelling, you went from the training phase to the walk out, if you like, and didn't talk so much about the actual fighting and killing that you were asked to do as a soldier. Is that because it's the most difficult thing to talk about, or?
Sometimes it makes me angry, because sometimes you feel a bit guilty and you can't face the question, so. And also bringing those pictures back is what. But sometimes it depends on the moment I am, I can talk about it. Because it's graphical, it's not easy to talk about. And part about that also, the parts that I'm talking about, like me almost eating my friend, that's a highlight for me, because it has never happened. I've seen people dying from when I was a kid. I think the first person was shot next to me. I was, I think, 5 or 4. Somebody was shot, and I saw the intestine coming out. It was, and my mother was trying to put the intestine back into the belly, trying to help the person. So that, to me, has been there from the beginning. But also participating into mobbing and killing people also, and talking about it, highlighting it, is hard. So I normally leave it for people to go and read it and find it out or see the documentary. But the book is more graphical.
since I did this book, I find it hard to read it. The first time when we're writing the book, I started nosebleeding every day. Like I wake up and I call the writer and tell him, my nose is bleeding. And I started having high blood pressure. But there was no nightmares for the almost 1 month. And so I'd ask, why am I nose bleeding? So, and I was told, okay, you have stress and your blood pressure is high, but because you're not releasing your emotions, that's why your body's reacting that way. Then all of a sudden, I had nightmares that I even hated started hating the writer. So, and once I finished writing the book, I became light. So everything is there, and I have it in my mind. Sometimes I don't want to talk, depending on the moment. Sometimes I may talk about it, and it doesn't hurt me. But through the music, it's easy to say everything without causing much damage.
Mentioning music, I know the one thing we're going to be looking forward to momentarily is that you're willing to perform for us. Just a couple more questions then. I think in the back, there.
Is it working? I think the lady behind was trying to say as well, but just a sense of, I think probably people hearing this, you can walk away and think, that was horrific and shocking to hear some of those things, and then you can sink back into your normal everyday life comfortably for ourselves. What single thing might you like to think that people walking away from tonight might do that might support the work you're doing?
Okay. There are a lot of ways people could support me. I've come with my books. I have my book here. I've got my music and a movie about my life. Also, I've done it, so maybe you could read it and show other people. It will help the word spread quickly. But if you want to participate directly into the school that I'm building, I could say the website, it's www.gua-africa.org. But what I could say is there's nothing greater than investing in a human being, investing in a life, because that's the only way we can change the world. Because look at her. Emma wasn't a rich woman, but she left England and said there's a need and she wanna do it. And here I am today traveling. Not only am I a blessing to a lot of people, but I've happened to make sure there's 41 kids in school now. We have got guys in universities, we have got kids in primary schools, and that's through one person helping me, and I'm able to do that. So I'll just ask you, the need is all over the world. It could be a kids in the street of London, you know, it could be in China, it could be somebody, you know. So if you stretch your hand, you may never know who you're planting a seed with. And that's the only way we can change the world, if we care, because nothing beat love, really, because that's what love is. And so we've been at war for many years, but let's give love a chance. Action will speak louder, because I don't want to talk more. I'll just keep it there.
Thank you. And I think, was there one last one in the back? Yes, there.
You said you didn't want to talk more, so I maybe shouldn't ask the big political question I was going to ask. But I just say Warchild is an amazing album. I'm just wondering, if you said that music is your therapy. Are you getting enough therapy? Are you actually recording a lot at the moment? And when can we expect a new album? The sort of bigger question is, are you worried that it's going to happen again? Because there's going to be elections in Sudan next year. There's also a referendum eventually on whether the South becomes its own country. There's always traditionally been a big problem in the South, that unity between Southerners has always been a problem. So are you worried that things may actually go downhill in Sudan? As well, that's it.
There's a lot of tension, you know, when the government is still practicing its divide and rule tactics. So there's always, every week, there's something happening. Tribe clashing, fighting each other. These other people have been given guns. People know where the guns came from. Another village is raided. So there's a lot of things happening in South. But the leaders of South Sudan really want this peace to happen. But there's a lot of tension, you know, because of people who have invested and for years made millions of money out of the war. So they don't want this war to really end because it's a big business for other people. And what I'm doing now is I'm working on my next album. So I'm trying to see how I'm gonna get it out there, but I'm on studios. I was signed to a record label, but we've disagreed now, so I'm now on my own again, which is good. I can write music that I like the most. And so sometime next year, I should be able to come out with a new album. But this time, it's gonna be fun. More fun, you know? So maybe I'll sing songs, you know, about ladies. Cause I got inspired, I came to England, you know, so travel America. And so expect songs of, along those lines. You know.
If there are any other questions, I think Jal has kindly agreed to stay a bit afterwards and sign books and so on. Your story is a very personal one that you are willing to put out there and tell the rest of us, and certainly in this intimate surrounding here, I can't thank you enough for sharing this time with us. And thank you, Jal.
Thank you.
So now what I'm going to do, I'm not going to get so much crazy because I normally put a lot of energy in my music where like I get really, really crazy. I'll just put less energy now so I don't distract first guys. But I'll ask you for, if you could stand. And the cool thing with hip hop is, if you don't know how to dance, nobody will really know because you just go like, just shake your head, you know? So just go like that. If you wanna go a bit, you can. Yeah? You guys ready with me? All right, cool. We're gonna celebrate Emma McCune. This one goes to Emma McCune. Angel to the rescue one afternoon. I'm here because you rescued me. I'm proud and glad you're here. Thank you. Bless you. R.I.P.
The telly, bad on the belly, flies in my eyes, said to pick from my side. Just another little disturbing child, running around in half a cup, on to be wild. Praise God, praise the Almighty for sending an angel to rescue me. I got a reason for being on this earth, cause no more than many other life is working. Get a chance to stand my ground. I'm gonna run over mountains, leaves and bells. I ain't an angel, hope I'll be one soon. And if I am, I wanna be like Emma McCune. Me,
what would I be?
Me,
never, never rescue me.
What would I be?
What would I be?
Me,
another
stopping
refugee.
What would I be?
What
from starvation,
yeah,
or some other wretched disease,
yeah.
I would have grown up with no education,
yeah,
just another refugee,
yeah.
I stand up because somebody cared. Because somebody cared. Small, where I can read or write at all. Now I'm all grown up, I got my education. The sky is the limit and I can't be stopped by no one. Oh, I pray for this day to come. And I pray that the world find wisdom. Forget the poor in need is some assistance. Instead of putting up resistance, yeah. Sitting and waiting for the politics of Texas. It ain't gonna happen. They're all sitting on their asses. Popping champagne and scrunching up the masses. Coming from the refugee boy soldier, but I still got my dignity. I gotta say it again, we're gonna never rest it. I'll be a cop from the African plane. Gotta have some love at the back. Yeah, I know what I mean. Let me do my little. Okay, go ahead. Thank you.